Dateline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army. Army officers say the missile, found sometime last week, has been inspected at Roswell, New Mexico, and sent to Wright Field, Ohio, for further inspection.
Time is late December 1947. The world is just beginning to recover from the most devastating war in its long history of very costly wars. Tens of millions of people died in this great battle for freedom. Despite complete victory by the Allied nations over the forces of tyranny in the middle of the 20th century, peace is by no means a certainty. Powerful nations who just a few short years ago stood solidly together against those dark forces of repression are already deeply suspicious of their former allies' intentions. In fact, these former allies stand ready to begin yet another horrific war. Little do these powerful nations know that alien beings from beyond their tiny world are also deeply concerned about our Earth's future plans. The last war on Earth saw the rapid and unchecked development of terrible new weapons of mass destruction, unprecedented advances in jet power, and more importantly, rocketry that can already deliver these terrible weapons to the very edge of outer space. Beginning in June of 1947, people around the world have been witnessing these strange objects in the sky that quickly became known by the media as flying saucers. So, what are these flying saucers? From where do these flying saucers come? Are they friend or are they foe? People everywhere anxiously await the answer. The stage is now set for Earth to receive its first verified visitor from space.
This story begins on December 22nd, 1947. A flight of Kentucky Air National Guard F-51 Mustangs encountered a strange flying craft over the skies of the Bluegrass State.
Godman Tower, this is Bloodhound Leader. Over.
Go ahead, Bloodhound Leader. Over.
I've sighted the object. I estimate it to be approximately, 5 miles northeast of our current position and on the move. Bloodhound flight is closing in. Over.
Roger, Bloodhound Leader. We have you and the object on radar. Please give us a description of the object. Over.
Given my estimated distance, the object appears quite large. It is bright white and appears to have a reddish flame at its tail, trailing a green gas. Over.
Bloodhound Leader, do you believe it is a meteor? Over.
The object is moving at a high rate of speed, but I don't believe it's fast enough to be a meteor. It appears to be maneuvering as if it is a controlled flight. Over.
Copy that, Bloodhound Leader. Bloodhound flight is to maintain safe distance and stand by. Over.
Roger, Godman Tower, standing by.
Rest assured, what I am about to report to you is absolutely true.
Bloodhound Leader, this is Godman Tower. Come in. Over. Bloodhound Leader, this is Godman Tower. Do you copy? Over. Come in, Bloodhound Leader. This is Godman Tower. Over.
Godman Tower, this is Bloodhound 2. I had a visual on Leader following the object in rapid ascent.
Roger, copy, Bloodhound 2. What is Bloodhound Leader's status? Over.
I went witnessed a large fireball. Now don't spot anything. Nothing. Over.
Roger, Bloodhound 2. Stand by. You'd better get General Fogarty on the line right away.
General Fogarty immediately launched a full-scale search for the missing pilot and his F-51. This massive effort was unsuccessful. The general realized he needed to call on Project Saucer.
Well, Colonel, thanks for having me here. So let's get down to business. Do you really believe in any of this crazy flying saucer stuff that, you know, you've been telling me about, Colonel Alice?
Well, Dutch, I know you've got a job to do, but so do I. And honestly, it doesn't really matter what I believe. I do know that my crews and I saw those Foo Fighters during the war, and they were very, very strange. And now it's our job to investigate these things that are being called flying saucers.
But Colonel, don't you think they shuffled you off to this little desk, crazy desk job just to get you to finally retire from the new U.S. Air Force?
Well, that may be, but that's the life I chose a long time ago, Dutch.
Well, surely you don't take any stock in these reports about the flying saucers. I mean, it's a bunch of otherwise normal people who are just trying to make a name for themselves.
Well, you know, I understand there's a lot of questions about it. That's why our team is investigating this. But I will tell you this. Our team has investigated... Oh, excuse me, Dutch. Project Saucer, this is Colonel Hallis.
We have a problem, Hallis. We lost a Kentucky Air National Guard pilot chasing some kind of object over northern Kentucky.
When did this happen, General Fogarty?
About 3 hours ago. The details are very sketchy.
What's the status of the F-51 pilot, sir?
The status is unclear.
Well, unclear? What does that mean, sir, unclear?
Exactly that, Colonel Hallis. Unclear.
Well, shouldn't this be a job for the regular Air Force, sir?
I would have called them if I thought so, Colonel Hallis. We aren't sure what we're facing here. It's your job to find out when we can get you your team there.
Yes, sir. I understand. I can have a team assembled and we can be in Cincinnati in 2 days.
Make that one day, Colonel. I'll have a C-47 ready for you at 1400 hours tomorrow. By the way, you'll be working with some research scientists who are familiar with what happened with Arnold and at Roswell. Dutch Myers from UPI will also be tagging along. Work with all of them, Colonel.
I understand, sir. Dutch Myers is here with me right now, in fact. Having the research team there will certainly help us. And I can fill Dutch in if you want me to.
Okay, Colonel. Let Dutch know. He's an American hero, Hallis. You know what he did in the last war, but you had better keep a close eye on him.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Take care.
So, something's really cooking.
Yeah, Dutch, it looks like it is, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to leave. But you can meet us at Lunkin Airport tomorrow afternoon, because there is definitely something cooking.
Great. I'll tell my editor. That ought to make him happy for a change.
Well, then
I'll see you at Lunkin tomorrow.
See you tomorrow, Dutch. Thank you. Sergeant Murdoch, can you come into my office, please?
Yes, sir.
Have a seat. Well, Ken, it seems that some Kentucky National Guard pilots were chasing some kind of craft last night, and one of them got fouled up.
Some kind of craft, Mike? You mean like those V-2s that we've been testing out in Las Cruces, New Mexico?
Well, Sergeant, the V-2s don't have that kind of range. Besides, no V-2s were sent up that day. It was some kind of unknown craft or other kind of rocket. The details are very sketchy right now. That's why I need you to get ready to join me and the team. We're heading down to Lunkin Airport in Cincinnati. I'll need you for communications, and I'll get Sergeant Billings, Captain Thomas, and I'm going to send Sergeant Wilson down ahead of us to start getting things set up. So we'll leave tomorrow at 1400 hours.
We go back a ways, Mike. If I may ask, you mean that one of those pilots may have been fouled up?
Well, he's missing. He may have crashed. Or maybe he was shot down.
shot down, sir. You mean by the Russians?
I don't know. But it was shot down, and it wasn't from one of our craft. I know it sure as Truman wasn't the Canadians.
No, sir. What's our assignment?
Well, we gotta try to figure out what the devil's going on. So let's get moving on the double.
Yes, sir. And a very Merry Christmas to you, Sergeant Murdoch.
We'll be meeting a team of research scientists and a UPI reporter at Lunken Field. Jack Wilson's joining us there too. The scientists have been studying events in Mount Rainier and Roswell. They're supposed to be the best, and the reporter is Dutch Myers.
Oh yeah, and the scientists are best at what, Colonel?
Yes, sir, I sure am looking forward to tripping over a bunch of crackpot civilians.
Let's hope they're not crackpots, Ken. Besides, your job is to keep us in communication with General Fogarty at Wright Field. These crackpots, as you call them, shouldn't be getting in your way.
I'll see to that, Sergeant Murdoch.
I'll just bet you will, Captain. Have you had to deal with these eggheads before? Because I have. They're a handful. And why do we have Dutch Myers there?
Well, because General Fogarty told us so. By the way, Captain Thomas, let's hope your Russian is as good as your resume says it is.
Da Kuroshki. Yes, good in Russian. That's my robota job in Russian. 4 years studying Russian language at Ohio University.
And oh, you, Bobcat, eh?
Yes, Sergeant. But Colonel, do you really think we're dealing with the Russians? What's their real Vabros problem in Russian?
I don't know that. It's all very strange. I hope not, because otherwise, if they can reach our Midwest with some kind of high-speed craft, to tell you the truth, it will be the least of our concern if your Russian is good or not. But we have to find out either way.
Maybe these pilots are chasing a star or the planet Venus or reflections on their canopies.
Well, that has happened before, sir.
Well, I know what we're all thinking. This may be one of those mysterious flying saucers.
Yeah, I agree, but we all may be wrong. I'm reading an Air Force publication on those reports of flying saucers. Department of Defense, Office of Public Information, Washington, D.C., the 17th of December, 1947. It's Bulletin 392-67 regarding item 42345 extract 42716. It says the Air Force has discontinued the investigation and evaluation of flying saucers because there's no evidence. The Air Force says the sightings are a result of swamp gas, thermal inversion, mass hysteria, jokes, or just mistaken sightings of conventional aircraft.
I guess that explains why we all work for an Air Force unit called Project Saucer, right?
Say, Sergeant, what did you say the number on that bulletin was?
392-67, item 42345, extract 42716.
Oh, that one.
Look, man, the pilot was a World War II veteran. He flew strafing runs on D-Day. We have to assume that he knows or knew what he was doing.
Sounds like a tough break.
Yep, to survive the war and then...
And then what, sir?
That's what we need to find out. And please, everyone, let's do our best to get along with the civilian scientist and Dutch Myers, at least until they give us a reason not to.
I certainly hope this group of the Air Force let us do our research, Dr. Clayton.
I was given complete assurance that they wouldn't be in our way, Dr. Gordon.
Well, we were given the same assurance in Roswell, Doctor. You certainly don't think they lived up to that, do you?
Perhaps not, Dr. Corrigan. They believed that the public wasn't ready to deal with the possibility of visitors from another world or come to grips with the fact that there may be more advanced civilizations than ours visiting us.
Well, given the last war, it wouldn't take much to find a civilization more advanced than ours.
It would seem so, Dr. Corrigan. It would seem so. Either way, we're tasked with giving a full report on what we find to the Majestic 12 group.
I hope we're ready for that.
Yes.
Dr. Clayton, Colonel Mike Hallis, Air Force Project Saucer.
Yes, a pleasure to meet you, Colonel Hallis. General Fogarty told us that you were on your way.
And you are?
This is Dr. Lisa Corrigan. She is the Doctor of Astrophysics.
Impressive. Pleasure to meet you, Doctor. Let me introduce the rest of my special investigative team. This is Sergeant Murdoch. He's in charge of communications. This is First Sergeant Wilson, been with me for years. And this is Captain Thomas. He'll be our Russian translator.
And what's so special about this investigation, Colonel Hallis?
Well, one of our pilots is missing and presumed dead, ma'am.
Captain Thomas speaks Russian, Colonel? Surely you don't believe we're going to be dealing with Russians.
Well, I don't know. That's why we're here. We're going to find out what we're up against. That's my job, and that's exactly what I intend to do.
And the Colonel generally means business, doctors. Except, of course, when he's on leave. Isn't that right, Colonel?
I was Colonel Hallis' flight engineer when we were dropping bombs on the Nazis during the war. We always meant business.
Okay, man, that'll be enough of that.
Gentlemen, I don't believe our time here will have anything to do with leave. And I don't think we have to worry about running into any Nazis. If I may suggest, I believe we should proceed across the river into Kentucky to where Dr. Corrigan and I believe the crash site is located.
Crash site, Doctor?
Yes, Captain, crash site.
Here I thought this was going to be a boring assignment.
It doesn't appear so, Sergeant Wilson.
Hey, is this where the party is?
Dutch Myers, good to see you again.
Thank you, Colonel. I told you I'd be here.
And you are here.
Yes, sir.
Hello, Mr. Myers. UPI. So get it first, but first get it right.
You got that exactly right.
Very good.
And who are you?
Dr. Lisa Corrigan. And how are you, Dutch?
My.
Very Merry Christmas, everyone.
Well, let's get moving then.
The investigative team traveled from Lunken Airport across back roads and old bridges to the base camp that had already been established by Sergeant Jack Wilson.
Are we communicating with Wright Field, Sergeant Murdoch?
As soon as the vacuum tubes warm up, we're open for business, Colonel.
The camp was next to an old country bar called Angelo's Tavern, located in Independence, Kentucky. They held their first strategy meeting in the tavern that evening.
Colonel Hollis, this is the third scientist on our team, Dr. Heinrich Beck. His specialty is radiation sciences.
Mike Hollis, Doctor. Radiation sciences?
Yes, Colonel. I've been taking readings, Geiger counter readings in the woods where the crash occurred, and the readings are astonishing.
Astonishing?
Yes, Colonel. Beck has been getting readings that far exceed anything that we found immediately following the atomic blast in Japan. It's incredible.
Looks like I got a big story.
Not until General Fogarty gives us clearance, but there's been no reports of an explosion, much less an atomic blast.
We don't think these readings are a result of an explosion, Colonel. It's something else that...
Well, no, we believe that these readings are a result of some kind of nuclear fuel being spread across the countryside, resulting from the crash of the vehicle.
Vehicle? Holy Moses.
Yeah, I think this calls for a very big drink.
Captain, go tell Murdoch to radio an encoded message to Wright Field. This area has to be cordoned off for how many miles, Dr. Clay?
A 10-mile radius should do nicely.
Okay, so 10 miles it is. Have Murdoch send that message and remember it has to be in code, okay? So we just can't alarm the civilian authorities here. We don't want to start a panic. We're just telling them we're searching for the debris of the F-51.
Normally, I am not one for deception, Colonel Hollis, but in this case, I believe it is a wise decision.
I can tell you almost exactly where we need to search.
Almost exactly. This ought to be good.
Let me help you, gentlemen. Godman Tower is located right here in Frankfurt. Immediately following the disappearance of your airplane, the control tower continued to track the identified object for another 162 seconds on radar. Then the radar target disappeared. My theory? The object hit the ground.
So, you're a psychic scientist?
Of course not. It's simple math. According to the radar tracking and the coefficient of friction, the original altitude was 27,000 feet. It was descending at 6,000 feet for every 36 seconds, heading in a northeast direction here. Gentlemen, this flying object was traveling at an amazing and steady rate of speed of 1,200 miles an hour. So, that simple math tells us that the object traveled a distance of 54 miles, which puts it about here before hitting the ground. More or less here. This area is known as Independence, Kentucky.
How in the world can you be so sure?
Sergeant Wilson, it isn't that difficult. And it may have nothing to do with our world. This is the kind of basic math calculations that any of your navigators would have done during the war.
The Flying Fortress could never do 1,200 miles per hour. With a full bomb load, a B-17 could be lucky to make 250 miles per hour.
Look, you three are the scientists here. Exactly what do you think we're dealing with? Do we need to alert Wright Field about some kind of a possible attack?
If we are about to be attacked, there is very little you'll be able to do about it, Colonel Hollis.
I beg your pardon.
What Dr. Corrigan is saying is that if what we are, as you said, dealing with some impending attack, it will not be from the Russians or any other nation on Earth for that matter.
Come on, Doctor. What you're saying, it's just too unbelievable.
Something doesn't require belief in order to be true, Colonel.
So what are you saying?
Yeah, what are you saying, Doctor?
Colonel, you know the possible capabilities of your potential enemies around the world better than we do.
Yes, I suppose that's true.
Well, Colonel, are you aware of any nation as flying nuclear-fueled aircraft? Or a nation that has craft capable of flying at incredible rates of speed reported by the Air National Guard pilots?
No, but maybe the German scientists rounded up by the Russians at the end of the war. Maybe they developed something.
That isn't likely, Colonel. We are many, many years away from the ability to use nuclear fuel in any way in any of our vehicles. And the Germans weren't working on these at the end of the war.
Well, what then?
We have evidence from our work at Mount Rainier and especially Roswell that Earth is being visited by beings from another planet.
That's just too fantastic.
It is certainly possible if they are doing it, Colonel. Dr. Beck, I suggest you and I take some radiation readings. Please excuse us, everyone.
Yeah, and I think I want to head to the camp for tonight. Maybe they'll let me use the radio.
Not until General Fogarty says it's okay, Dutch. Sorry.
Colonel Hollis, I'm going to head back to the camp and make sure everything's squared away.
Thank you, First Sergeant.
Murdoch, get this coded message to Wright Field right away.
What's going on, sir?
How in the world is the brass going to explain this to the people around here? I mean, isn't it going to set off some alarm bells?
Well, I hope not, but maybe alarm bells are exactly what we need. Let me know as soon as you get a reply.
Yes, sir, Captain Thomas.
General Fogarty ordered the military police to take swift action after he received Project Saucer's request to cordon off the crash site. The military police worked closely with local authorities, and all roads into and out of the designated area were quickly closed. As Napoleon once said, an army travels on its stomach. Sergeant Wilson served up the first meal for the Project Saucer men. The meal included a heaping portion of good old American military wisecracks.
Ken, what's going on back there?
I think I may be the wrong guy to ask, buddy. I gotta get this message off to the captain. Gotta get a reply to the captain. Are we all set for nightfall here?
As set as we can be. Jack, what's for dinner?
Spam and beans, boys. Spam and beans.
Only the best from the United States Air Force. We are the guys who investigate these non-existent flying saucers. Thanks. And after all
right.
Merry Christmas, guys.
You know, these are probably the same ones we've been having since the war. You're gonna love it just like it was Christmas dinner at Mama's house.
This is probably food left over from World War II.
I wouldn't be surprised.
There you go. Welcome to Angelo's.
Thank you.
Sir, did you fight in the war?
Yes, I did. I flew B-17 missions in Europe.
The owner thought so. This is on the house for you guys. There's our best Kentucky bourbon.
Well, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
And this is for you, and Merry Christmas
thank
to you.
You. Thank Merry you Christmas to both of you, and thank you for your service, Colonel.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. How polite for a war hero. Strong.
Yes, it is. Welcome to Kentucky, I guess. Look, Dr. Corrigan, I'm sorry if we got off to a bad start.
We haven't gotten off to any start, Colonel Miles.
What I mean is that, you know, I know you don't want the military here, but we're just trying to do our job.
Well, that's what my husband did in the war, Colonel.
Well, how does a traveling doctor of astrophysics have time for married life?
As my husband was killed in the war, Colonel, like you, he was in the Air Corps. He was flying B-29 missions over Japan and was shot down very late in the war. I have a hard time with military approach to these issues.
Look, Dr. Corrigan, I'm very sorry about that. I'm sorry about your husband, but you have to understand that the last people that want a war would be the ones that are going to have to fight it.
Unless, of course, you are ordering other men to do the killing while you are safe out of harm's way.
Dr. Corrigan, I flew 38 B-17 missions over Europe during the war. A lot of my buddies were killed doing the same thing. I mean, maximum effort is a very, very terrible thing, but we were fighting people like Hitler and Tojo. Again, I'm sorry about your husband. I'm sure he was a great guy.
Yes, he was. He also talked about the importance of maximum effort. I guess that's exactly what he gave. Look, it isn't your fault that you came home and he didn't. I buried myself in my work to deal with it.
Here's another round in the house.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Here you go. This is for you again.
Thank you very much, Merry Christmas. Sir. Thank you. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Thank you.
So you ready for more bourbon?
Yeah. It's good. It's strong, but it's good.
Okay, well, you know, Doctor, the other thing is, I don't think we need to be so formal. My friends call me Mike. Would you please call me Mike?
Then you can call me Doctor.
Okay, Doctor.
Well, no, really, my name's Lisa. I guess that was my scientist's attempt at humor.
That was funny. And that's a very pretty name, Lisa.
Thank you. Well, listen, you know, I really don't blame you for what happened to my husband. But you have to understand that...
Listen, I do understand. I lost a lot of friends during the war, and sometimes I think, you know, I wonder, was it worth it? And then I realize that I'm dishonoring them when I think that.
Well, what do you mean by that?
Well, again, we were fighting, you know, some really bad guys. I mean, what do you think the world would be like if we hadn't won the war?
Well, what do you think the world is like now? We were just taking a little break, getting ready to fight the Russians.
See, that isn't how I see things. The way I see it, it's exactly the opposite of that. Not like before Pearl Harbor. I mean, well then, you know, if we're ready, if we're strong, then no one will dare start another war with us.
So maybe we start the war. Here's a couple cups of coffee to warm you guys up.
Well, thank you again. Thanks for your generosity. I really appreciate it.
You're very welcome, sir.
Here again. This is for you again.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you, too.
Maybe she thinks we're drinking too much.
Could be. But, you know, Doctor, again, I don't think America has any intention of starting a war. In fact, I think that we just want to be left alone. That's why we're going to be traipsing around in the woods tomorrow, because we don't want any surprises.
Well, you do make sense, just like my husband did. But I'm sure we're bound to be surprised why we are, as you put it, traipsing around in the woods.
Well, that's what worries me.
Oh, look, here comes Dr. Clayton.
Okay, great.
Colonel Hallis would soon have a serious reason to worry. Two hunters were in the woods searching for the main course for their family's Christmas dinners. They encountered something they would not forget for the rest of their lives.
You see what I see?
Yeah, but Manny, what was that?
It didn't look like any turkey or deer I ever seen. But I need something for Christmas dinner.
Oh, I ain't gonna be serving that to none of my family this Christmas.
Well, then we gotta go tell somebody what we just saw.
Yeah, but who's gonna believe us?
That ain't our problem, Jimmy. But whatever's out there could be.
I'm telling you, Major.
Captain. It's Captain Jason Thomas, Air Technical Intelligence Center.
Okay, Captain. Whatever it was we saw out there in the woods, and we absolutely saw something, you're going to have to figure it out. We were over there in the woods. We're walking through, and it was moving around, like, from tree to tree. I was the first one to see it.
Well, what was it?
Well, it was a man, but not a man.
Well, that doesn't make much sense, fellas.
Not a lot about this has made sense so far.
Hey, have you guys been drinking?
All right, guys, knock it off. Look, if it was a man, but it wasn't a man, then what do you think it was?
Well, Major, it...
Captain. It's Captain.
Well, Captain, it looked like a big jack-o'-lantern.
Oh, come on. Halloween was almost 2 months ago.
Hey.
What's going on out there?
Hey, that thing had a head twice the size of mine.
And he's got a big head.
Yeah, he does. Come on, what's happening out there?
Okay. Let's get these guys some coffee. And then, Murdoch, you better hustle off and get the colonel.
Captain, we just got a reply from right field. General Fogarty tells us because of the radiation levels, we're ordered to keep our distance.
Well, it's too late for that.
So what in the world was going on?
It may have nothing to do with this world.
Oh, come on. That's nuts, Thomas. What is happening out there? Give me something.
Murdoch, get the colonel. Now.
Yes, sir, Captain Thomas.
I'm going to go with him. This I got to see.
Sergeant Murdoch and Dutch Myers quickly headed to Angelo's Tavern to update Colonel Hallis. The sergeant was very reluctant to reveal what had been learned from the 200's strange encounter in front of the scientist.
Dr. Back and I encountered some very interesting...
Begging your pardon, sir, but we have a situation.
Go ahead.
But, sir...
Look, Sergeant, the scientists and Dutch Myers are on our side.
But some hunters saw something strange in the woods. It was a man, but it wasn't a man.
You know, I'm not really in the mood for riddles right now. Was it a man or wasn't it a man?
If I may, Colonel, it appears our two hunters have had an encounter with a being from another world.
It's late, Doctor.
Well, we found biological evidence at Roswell, Colonel.
Biological evidence of what?
Alien beings, Colonel.
But they were killed in the crash.
Yeah, how come that wasn't reported?
Now, that story was debunked. It turned out that was just a weather...
Debunked.
Weather balloon doing upper atmospheric tests, Dutch.
Or so your military colleagues said, Colonel.
Right. Assuming this is true, what should we be doing from the perspective of science, I mean?
I suggest we get some rest and head into the woods tomorrow morning at first light.
Okay, Billings, tell the men to get some sack time, but keep someone on watch all night and let them know we're going to be taking a little trip out into the woods tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
So, Dr. Beck, are we supposed to be heading in this direction according to your calculations?
Yes, generally we should be heading southwest. Perhaps I should say we should be heading that direction. And my Geiger counter readings should determine that.
I'm not really sure that's a good idea.
We came here to get answers, and that's the only way we're going to be able to do it.
Well, I'm not even sure I know what the question is now.
Why do you see a need for weapons, Colonel?
What would you suggest we do if we run into a very angry bear?
That's the least of our worries at this point.
You have got to be kidding me.
Besides, do you plan on killing a bear with a bazooka and a machine gun?
It could be a very large bear, ma'am.
I'll do whatever it takes.
If you gentlemen are finished, shall we proceed?
That's great. Okay, let's move out, everybody.
Captain, look to the right.
Colonel, over here.
What is it?
I don't know, but I'd like to see what General Fogarty has to say about that.
I wouldn't want to hear it.
Now that is very strange. Dr. Clayton, would you please come here?
What is it, Colonel?
Look over to the right of our position.
It isn't any Russian I'm familiar with.
Just as I thought, Doctor. Oregon. Do you see it?
Yes, yes, I see it. We have finally seen a visitor from another world.
Well, at least we know it isn't the Russians.
To say the least.
Holy cats! An actual visitor from another planet? I've got to report this right away.
Not yet, Dutch.
Oh, you can't stop me from reporting this, Colonel. This is the biggest story since Moses parted the Red Sea!
No dice, Dutch.
No dice? The First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution disagrees with you, Colonel. You take your orders from the freedom of the press.
Look, Dutch, I take my orders from the United States Air Force. I'll be happy to forward your request on to General Fogarty.
Oh! What's the problem with Colonel Hallis?
It's no problem, Dutch. Colonel Hallis is Air Force all the way, just like the rest of us. We follow orders, we complete the mission.
So, the mission is everything?
Now you got it. The mission is everything with us. I mean, isn't it your mission to get the story?
Yeah, well, okay, Sergeant, okay, I get it, but I haven't been able to get the story out to my editor.
Not yet, anyway. Not yet. We're gonna get the mission done, move forward. That's why we're here, Dutch.
Okay, let's get moving. I don't think the visitor realizes that we're here just yet, but we'll want to keep a safe distance. Captain Thomas, radio Murdoch and tell him that we're following something, but be very vague.
I think it is.
Dutch, maybe you should get out of here.
And where exactly do you think I should go, Colonel?
Well, Jack, do you think I should tell him where I think he should go?
Not if you hope to finish your career with the good old United States Air Force with a more or less unblemished record, Colonel.
I think you're right. Okay, let's get moving.
Dr. Clayton, do you hear that low-pitched noise?
What is it?
I hear it.
This is incredible.
Well, now we know what the F-51s were chasing. Captain Thomas, radio Murdoch and let him know we've made contact.
You remember that? Shock we felt the first time we saw that Kraut 262, Colonel?
I sure do, Sergeant.
Well,
Well, that doesn't hold a candle to this.
No, no it doesn't.
Oh, you gotta let me come up and get some pictures.
Not yet, Dutch, not yet.
Make sure we get that message out, Captain Thomas.
Yes, sir, yes. Well, we've made contact. Simple as that.
Come on, Colonel, you can't keep this a secret.
Not till...
Let me radio the UPI.
Not till General Fogarty says I can, Dutch.
Oh.
This is the greatest discovery in all of mankind's recorded history.
You'll get no argument from me on that, Doctor.
There is hope for you yet, Colonel.
I certainly hope so.
The Colonel is one of the most hopeful people I know.
Dr. Clayton, our visitor, has been in his craft now for about a half an hour. What do you think he, or whatever it is up to?
Well, perhaps he is trying to effect repairs so that the spaceship can return to wherever it comes from.
Colonel, there's all kinds of static in the radio. Murdoch's having a hard time talking to us. I'm picking up on the walkie-talkie, too. It's almost impossible to understand Murdoch.
Murdoch may have his faults just like the rest of us, but that guy sure knows radios.
Now it's beginning to make sense.
What do you mean, Doctor?
Yes, sir. This doesn't make much sense at all.
Our visitor has a homing beacon, and it is being picked up by your radios. This is a maze.
Doctor, the radiation levels are beginning to rise to very unsafe levels.
I just noticed my watch has stopped. It may be best move back.
Yeah, and this compass is spinning out of control, and I've noticed my watch has stopped too. I agree with Dr. Corrigan. I think we better move back.
This is getting to be a regular thing.
Might I suggest we return to base camp to discuss our next move?
Okay, everyone, let's move out. I'll bring up the rear.
You don't have to say that twice, sir.
Everyone can follow me. I didn't survive D-Day by trying to be a hero.
Well, thanks for inviting me to this party first, Sergeant. Really appreciate it.
Don't thank me, Lee. Thank the Colonel. He knows how good you are with that rifle. You're the best shot we've got.
Well, I guess I'll just let it go. You don't think I'm going to have to shoot someone or something, do you?
I hope not, Lee, because if you do, that means we are having a really bad day.
Oh, good. Nothing better than soldiers griping.
We haven't even got started griping yet, Dutch.
Very, very entertaining.
Come on, let's go, guys.
This is the strangest music, or whatever it is, I've ever heard. What in the world's happening? Red River Base to Red River One. Red River Base to Red River One. Come in, Red River One. Nothing. The Colonel sure isn't going to be happy about this. I can't reach anybody.
The team spent a sleepless night discussing what their next move should be. It had become obvious to everyone that they were facing something that was not from this world.
Colonel, I have a message from Wright Field for you and Dr. Clayton.
Let's have it.
Well, observatories around the Earth have spotted something orbiting the Earth.
What?
This is incredible. They're coming to rescue their stranded explorer.
Or it could be an invasion. We've got to let Wright Field know what's going on immediately.
It's your call, Colonel. That's what General Fogarty said.
Well, can we at least return to the crash site and try to make contact? This may be nothing more than the harmless recovery of a fellow being.
Or the beginning of an interplanetary war.
And if your colleagues harm the alien, it may be just that.
Well, that's a fine choice.
Well, let's go back to the site and try to make contact before it's too late. I don't want to be responsible for a war. No more killing.
I see no harm in attempting to contact the friend we have in the woods there.
Okay, I'll give it 1 hour. Lee, you're coming along this time. Bring the rifle and some extra ammunition.
Yes, sir. You've picked the right man for the job.
Ken, at 0900, hours here to give Wright Field a call about what's going on here.
Yes, sir, Colonel. Loud and clear. Every detail at 0900.
Remember that, Murdoch. Just 1 hour.
Yes, sir, Captain Thomas. Too many chiefs, not enough Indians. Oh, brother.
The Military High Command was closely monitoring the efforts of the Project Saucer team. After an emergency phone conference with President Truman and his Majestic 12 advisors, General Fogarty was given permission to issue a fateful order to the 509th Bombardment Group based in Roswell, New Mexico.
This is General Fogarty, radio code 1-869-47. Do you read me, Project Saucer Group? Over.
This is Project Saucer Group, General Sergeant Murdoch on the line. Over. Yes, sir, General Fogarty. Message received and understood. This message will be delivered now, sir. Over and out. Red River Base to Red River One. Come in, Red River One. Captain Thomas, I just got word from General Fogarty. A B-29 is headed our way from Roswell, and they have orders to drop an A-bomb on the crash site.
That's outrageous, Colonel. Dropping an atomic bomb on U.S. soil and a reckless action like this will wreak havoc on the world's ecosystem. And far worse, could trigger an interplanetary war. You must stop it.
This is absolute madness. Dropping an atomic bomb on a Kentucky countryside?
Okay, you're right. Thomas, radio Murdoch. Tell him to get a hold of Wright Field right away. That B-29 has to stand down. We've got everything under control here.
Yes, sir, right away.
Now I have heard and seen absolutely everything.
It sounds like old General Fogarty is in a panic.
No, General Fogarty would be in a panic if he ever gets the chance to shake hands with our friend in the woods.
Sir. We bought us some time. Murdoch says the B-29 is circling about 100 miles out, so we've got a little bit of time.
Finally, someone's made a sane decision.
But it won't hold off absolute disaster for long, I believe.
Okay, Dr. Clayton, what do we do now?
I suggest someone approach the craft alone. Perhaps our visitor will not be alarmed by one person coming forward. After all, we are alien to the being also.
I'll do it, Colonel.
No, I'm the language specialist also.
I suggest you two flip a coin.
Tails.
Heads.
How you flip a coin?
You gotta flip it like this.
Too late. Somebody's already gone.
Do not be alarmed. As you can see, I am able to communicate in your language. Colloquial English, correct?
Yes, that is correct. I am Dr. Lisa Corrigan. I mean you no harm.
I believe you, but I also know that your peaceful intentions are quite rare for your species. I am also aware that your military leadership intends to destroy me. And I know that a member of your party has a rifle pointed at me.
Yes, I know. But you're safe for the moment.
I've got a clear shot on him. It's just like shooting fish in a barrel.
Don't do anything unless I give you the order, Lee.
All right. I'm hoping he stays right there.
Who are you?
I am a Kohanim from a planet that orbits the star you call Alpha Centauri.
This is incredible. Do you have a name?
Nothing that would make sense to you.
So why are you here?
We have been visiting your planet for some time now, We have become concerned because your seemingly endless desire to destroy yourselves now seems to threaten other nearby planets.
I know we aren't a peaceful race. Far from it. But how are we threatening you?
We have watched the crude beginnings of your rocket programs for some time now. On this continent, and in the area you call the Soviet Union. Soon you will attempt to travel to other planets and take your warlike ways along with you.
But science also promotes peace and understanding.
Do you share your scientific advances with all the nations of your world?
Well, no. We have enemies who mean us harm.
And they see you in the exact way. Unfortunately, if you persist in your warlike ways, you will have more enemies than you could ever have imagined. Again, I know that members of your party intend to destroy me.
I won't allow that.
We have also observed that the female species is considered subordinate to the male. What makes you think that anyone will listen to you?
How much time do I have to convince them?
There is a craft circling your planet. Their mission is simply to rescue me. But they are capable of destruction beyond anything you can possibly imagine. If your race attempts to interfere with my rescue, they will arrive here in 68 of your minutes.
Please, please let me try.
I will do so. As you say, good luck. There is much at stake.
Squadrons of F-80 shooting star jets were ordered from Wright Field. General Fogarty sent them to the skies over the northern Kentucky crash site to face the mysterious approaching craft.
Dr. Corrigan, are you okay? Oh, what were you thinking? What happened?
Well, I'm okay. Our planet's going to be safe. Just trust me. I've been down there talking to the visitor. She's only asking for 68 minutes because that is when the rescue craft is going to come.
Rescue craft?
Yes.
Incredible. That explains all of the sightings.
It could be a rescue craft, or this could be a trick. They could be planning an invasion.
No, I don't think so. I trust her. I believe what she's telling me to be true.
Well, trust or not, if this is an attack, we won't be able to prevent it anyway.
Well, I've already promised that we will do no harm to her, but I guarantee you, if we do, our rescue attempt is going to definitely turn into an attack.
Well, this is quite a jam.
Well, you know, I must go back and tell her our decision as soon as possible.
If you ask me, Colonel, we have no choice but to wait.
Well, what I'll do is buy more time with General Fogarty then. So, good luck.
So I'm going to go now and talk to the visitor and tell him our decision.
Well, maybe we should go together.
Well, I think it's best for everyone if I go alone.
What's really going on here, Doctor?
Well, just between you and me, I don't want to tell anybody else yet. What I found out is from the visitor, she told me that the accident itself, or the crash was an accident. But her coming here to talk to us, that was planned. She's really concerned about the use of our atomic weapons and the safety of our planet.
Hey, I'm gonna wanna talk to you when you get back. If she gets back.
Hmm. Well, Dr. Clayton, I sure hope you were right. We got more time.
Well, we're gonna know if I'm right soon enough.
Hey, Colonel, you gotta cut me in. You gotta tell me what's going on here.
Okay, let me fill you in, Dutch.
Red River Base to Red River One. Come in, Red River One. Over.
Red River Base to Red River One. Come in, Captain Thomas. Over. Come on, baby. You've got to give Daddy a little help here. Dang it, no dice. Well, I never ducked out of a fight before in my life.
Well, looks like this is it. It's either them or me.
You know, Colonel, this is such a huge story, I can't wait to get it out to the UPI.
I'm sorry, Dutch, I just can't do it.
But you're trying to grow up to be another General Fogarty?
Yeah, I am, thank you.
Oh, come on.
I kept my word. We're leaving now.
Before you leave, Dr. Lisa Corrigan, there is one other thing.
Look, it's Dr. Corrigan and someone else.
Hey, isn't that the pilot?
I think that it is.
Oh my gosh, I thought you were lost. I'm so happy to see you.
So did I. I don't know how I got here.
Holy cow, you gotta let me take some pictures now, Colonel.
There's no point in waiting any longer, Dutch. Go ahead.
All right.
I'll take care of General Fogarty.
Well, good luck with that.
You both want to get out of here quickly. Stand by to a safe place. Again, good luck. Thank you, Dr. Lisa Corrigan.
And thank you for allowing me to work this out. Come on, Captain, let's get out of here.
You don't have to ask me twice.
Welcome back, son. It's very good to see you. It's great to be here. I don't know where I've been.
Do you mind if we check you for radiation?
That's a very good idea, Doctor.
Hey, I got a few questions for you here too, son. Why don't we go this way?
I want to follow them to make sure you can do that. I told you that was very dangerous.
All right, son, you've been through an ordeal. Can you tell me how long you were up on that ship?
I really don't know.
Do you have any idea how many people were on there with you, or if they were people at all?
I don't remember.
Well, do you remember anything?
No, I don't.
Do you remember the color of the interior of the ship?
It was blue.
It was blue. Okay, so was it a deep blue, a light blue? Dutch? Hey,
I promise I'm going to let you ask all of your questions, but let's make sure the captain's debriefed before that happens, okay? All right, let's get everybody together. Let's move out.
Well, when you were with the alien, did she say anything? Did you learn anything?
You know, I was in such a state of shock.
Did you see inside the spaceship? Did you see how it was powered?
I don't remember. She just seemed like she was here for a few reasons, but...
Well, we'll have to...
Colonel Hallis finally revealed everything he knew about the flying saucer phenomenon to Dutch Myers in the hope that the American public would eventually learn the entire truth.
Will you look at that? No one will ever believe this.
I don't think anyone's ever going to know about this, Lee.
Maybe, but I can't make any promises. You can't keep something like this a secret forever.
Well, chalk it up to another weather balloon, boys.
Yeah, maybe.
Man, we've seen way more than a weather balloon. The truth can't be hidden forever.
No one will ever believe this.
Oh, I think they will when I write my autobiography.
Wright Field is rating you directly.
Just tell them that we've recovered the pilot and we're on our way back. And let's move out, everybody. Don't worry, everybody. We've seen this strange static discharge before. We're all safe.
There's no radiation readings.
Well, that makes perfect sense, doesn't it?
Well, maybe this all makes sense to you guys, but it doesn't to me at all.
Well, this is way above all of our pay grades.
Way above everyone's pay grade.
This is going to be the best debriefing I ever had to sit through. I hope the whiskey is good.
Colonel, I'm guessing that bar is still open.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it is. Amen to that, my newly found friends.
Let me buy you all a drink.
I could sure use a stiff drink.
So could I.
A beer, maybe six would do.
That sounds good to me. I could use a little Christmas cheer.
I don't know if that's Air Force regulations, Colonel, but it sounds good to me.
I'm perfectly all right with it.
Guys, I'm sorry I left my radio, but I thought you could use my help.
We're glad you showed up anyway, buddy.
I'd sure like to join you. I could use a stiff drink, too.
Who couldn't use a good stiff drink after what just happened?
Oh, include me in that idea. That's one of the few good ideas that I've heard since I've joined this merry band of explorers.
In fact, you should include us all. Maybe all join you for a little Christmas cheer, Colonel Hollis?
I think we're all thirsty.
Absolutely.
Well, should we go have that drink now?
I wouldn't have it any other way. Let's go.
Project Saucer's work was finished, at least for now. But their secret mission would continue. The Air Force team, the scientists, and Dutch Myers would have many more adventures together for the next several years.
I assure you, everything I have told you is the absolute truth. Our Earth is definitely being visited by strange beings from another world, or perhaps concerned visitors from our own future. I stake my well-earned reporting reputation on this absolute fact. I have seen it firsthand. I was the fortunate participant who joined in a group of brave military men and brilliant scientists who encountered a strange visitor from what I will carefully describe as someplace else. Do I know where these strange beings came from? No, I do not. No serious person could make such a claim. Can they be visitors from other planets? Of course they can. Could they be visitors from Earth's own future? Again, that is also a possibility. But I know what I saw. You need to know that. What will happen next? Perhaps you need to ask the strange visitor we met in late December 1947.